everybody. My name is Julie Bank, and I'm the director of Riverside County Animal Services. I'm also a Monrovia resident. And as a pet lover, I have been getting a ton of calls and questions from individuals in the community asking about COVID and pets. So we thought it was a good opportunity right now to prepare a presentation for you so we can give you the up-to-date information about COVID and pets. I'm going to start a little bit about animal shelters in general, because as the director of an animal shelter, we are spending a lot of time talking to all the other directors of animal shelters across the country to make sure that we are staying up to date and keeping the public informed. Here in Monrovia, your animal shelter is the Pasadena Humane Society. And the Pasadena Humane Society is one of the shelters that we are regularly looking at and regularly talking to throughout this crisis. Now, in general, you need to know that animal shelter employees are essential workers. Just like police and fire, they are out there in the street keeping our streets safe. We're looking at things like animal cruelty investigations still. We're still picking up injured animals and dealing with public safety issues. So as essential providers, we have to make sure that we're keeping the staff and the public safe in everything that we're doing. And as a result, we had to change our programs. First of all, we had to go virtual. You're gonna see in the news and you're gonna see all over the place, virtual adoptions, virtual medical care, and some of that we're gonna talk about right now. First thing we needed to do is to make sure that we are gonna keep animals in the community rather than them having to come into the shelter. And what did that mean? That meant we put out a plea to the community to help us. And I wanna say thank you right now to all of you who have stepped forward to help the animal shelters when they have asked for help. We have seen a spike in adoptions, an increase in foster homes, and a foster home is where you take an animal for a temporary period of time, care for them, and when they are old enough or medically ready enough to come back, they then go up for adoption. We've seen all the groups working together to transfer animals from one facility to another facility. And we've also seen the community help their own neighbor by assisting pet owners. Can a pet get COVID-19? And I want to say that right now, and right now is an important point because things are changing every single day, but right now there is no evidence that a companion animal can spread COVID-19 from the animal to the person. Now, there have been cases in the community where there's been a small number of animals that have tested positive for the disease, but that has generally been indicated that it was the other way around. The owner of the animal had the disease, and the animal then became a carrier of the disease and was able to test positive. That's a very small amount. I'm saying there's literally been two cases of cats in the United States. We just learned that yesterday. And there have been a few cases abroad of animals. So in the scheme of the disease, animals play a very small role in the spread of the disease. And again, there's no evidence that it is being spread from an animal to a person. Now, I do want to say that things are changing every day. So the veterinary community and the animal sheltering community is looking at that and determining if something's going to change tomorrow. But as of right now, they are not part of the spread. Now, people have been asking a lot about testing, and we will talk in a little bit about testing. We should say that pets are not routinely being tested, which might have an indication of why we're not seeing as many positives. But right now, because the sample size of positive animals are so small, testing is not necessarily recommended. There's also been some question about whether the disease can stay on the fur of an animal. That's actually called a fomite, where there's one area and then you touch it and then another area can be infected. And while there's a small amount of evidence that animals can be fomites, it is understood that if the disease is on their fur, it's gonna go away pretty quickly. It's not like some other surfaces where it could take 2 to 3 days and stay there. It's pretty quick and it's pretty gone. So what if your pet shows no symptoms of the disease? And that's the best thing for all of us. You stay healthy and your pet stays healthy. We're telling you right now to continue normal behaviors with your pet. But most important is that you practice social distancing. And what that means is that you are staying away from other pet owners and you're staying away from other animals. So what you're doing for yourself, you're doing the same thing for the animal. So this is the time where you're gonna have lots of time to spend with your animals. Pet them, cuddle them, love on them, take them for walks. Do everything that you can to bond with your pet, but make sure it's you and your pet or you and your family's pet. You're not interacting with your neighbor's pet or you're not interacting with people when you're walking or any of that. We do recommend that if all possible that you bring your outdoor cats in so that there's no possibility that they are going to get in a contact with an animal that might have this disease or even any other disease. And wanted to talk for a brief minute about bathing, because that's been another question that people have been asking. Can I bathe my animals? If your animal normally gets bathed and you're seeing no signs of the disease, by all means bathe your animal. But we do recommend that you use personal protective equipment, or PEE, when you're bathing the animal. So that means masks, gloves, something to go over, a robe of some sort, because what you don't want to do is if there is something on your animal, have it aerosized and then get into your face. So make sure that you protect yourself if you are bathing your animals at this time. So what happens if you look at your animal and your animal is showing signs of needing regular veterinary care? Like animal shelters, most veterinary hospitals have suspended non-essential services as well. And some of that could even mean basic vaccine clinics or spaying and neutering, depending on the individual animal hospital. We recommend that you call your veterinarian to make sure that you know what your veterinary protocol is right now. But we are seeing more veterinarians going towards telemedicine as well as electronic record keeping. A lot of them are doing curbside pickup. Instead of having you come into their facility, you're driving into their parking lot, they're coming and getting the animal, doing their procedures and coming back. And they're really modifying what they have to do so that they can make sure that they are not part of the spread of the disease. So if you do see an animal that has any type of upper respiratory symptoms, first thing you want to do is call your veterinarian. Your veterinarian is gonna rule everything else out. He's gonna make sure it's not some other ailment, some other upper respiratory disease. If for some reason your veterinarian feels that there is a possibility that this could be COVID, which again, as I said earlier, there have been virtually no cases across the country to have any type of, to be speaking of. If for some reason your veterinarian does feel that this animal should then be tested for COVID, they will call the state veterinarian, and then the state veterinarian at that time will determine whether an animal should be tested. There was a company just yesterday that released a report where they tested 5,000 pets that were showing upper respiratory symptoms. And out of those 5,000 pets, zero of them tested positive for the coronavirus. So that's just an example of how little there is at this particular time. And insurance, some people have asked about their insurance and whether it would cover COVID issues. You do need to check with your insurance company, but in most cases, I have heard that if it covers upper respiratory illnesses, it's gonna cover this illness as well. So what happens if you have been exposed to COVID or somebody you know has been exposed to COVID and there's an animal that now has been exposed? We're saying treat the animal the exact way that you're gonna treat yourself. If possible, and if you're at home isolating or you have family members that are at home isolating, you should isolate that pet for 14 days. But keep that animal separate, again, like yourself, keep that animal separate from any other pets in the household. Anytime that you're gonna be around that animal, use PPE. Told you what that was before. Make sure you're minimizing contact, having all of your areas covered, and always wash your hands before and after any contact with the particular animal. There is no recommendations at this point to bathe the animal, but again, if you're gonna bathe the animal, make sure you're wearing PPE and that you protect yourself and the safety. And again, most important, make sure that if you suspect something, that you're in touch with your private veterinarian so that they can give you the next step of advice. So what happens if we are in the unfortunate situation where you need to leave the home because somebody is in your home being isolated, or unfortunately you need to go to the hospital because of your ailment? Right now, we're asking everybody out there to act as if you need a plan and hope that you don't need to ever use it. That means right now, you and your family should be incorporating a plan into your household that includes your pet. Number one, if you could take the pet with you, make sure that you do. The second part of that is in advance, you should be identifying a person that could be your proxy if you need to leave in a quick place. That person should know where your keys are. You should be leaving a authorization form so that other people and the authorities know who to call if there is a problem, or that you can access medical care for that pet because you're temporary being the owner of that particular pet. And then after you've done all that, you want to make sure that you have a backup plan, because with the way the virus is going right now, you just never know who's going to be impacted. And making sure that you have more than one person that knows the plan and can jump into action and take care of your pet is a really important thing. Want to make sure that you put together a to-go bag, which we'll talk about in a minute. And this is a tough topic to talk about, but we want you to think about your estate planning and make sure that planning for your pet is part of that. That means if you have a will or if you have an estate, you should be looking at it to see if there's anything in there. So if something happens to you, where's your pet gonna go and who can take care of your pet? And at a last resort, most animal shelters out there are there to help you. I know my animal shelter right now is working with vulnerable populations, and specifically populations of individuals experiencing homelessness, to try to see if we can do temporary boarding and assistance there. And there are animal shelters all over and in your area that are doing the same thing. So, to-go bags. What should be in my to-go bag? And by the way, the things I'm talking about right now are good for any type of disaster, not just COVID, an earthquake or any type of a disaster. This to-go bag is an extremely important thing. Right now, you want to make sure that you have 2 weeks of supplies. And that includes food and any other supplies that your animal might need, specifically medications or treatments for particular things. Look at it as a 2-week process. Remember, we were talking about 14-day isolation. That 2 weeks goes along with that 14-day of isolation. You always want to make sure you have a leash, a collar, and your animal is wearing identification tags. So if for some reason that animal gets lost, an animal shelter can get that animal back to you quickly. All that important authorization forms I was talking about before, you should have that in a Ziploc bag, including your dog's license paperwork and your vaccine and spay neuter records as well. I would also recommend that you have a picture of your animal so that if for some reason that animal gets lost with its caregiver, you can, that person has a picture and knows how to follow up and find them. You wanna make sure that kit is close to your front door. It's not gonna be helpful if it's tucked away in a closet, because in a case of emergency, you might not have enough time to go and get that kit from the front door, from the closet. So make sure that you know where it is and the person who is authorized also knows where it is and can grab it quickly. And another little tip, make sure it's the stuff that's in there. If you're putting their favorite blanket or their favorite bed or their favorite sweater in the to-go bag, make sure that it's washable, because if there's any type of exposure, we want to make sure that we can clean it and clean it well. So how can you help? And this has been the most heartwarming for me, is how many people not only are concerned about their human neighbors, but are also concerned about their four-legged neighbors. It's really been amazing. And again, thank you to all of you who have already stepped up to help. And thank you for those who might want to take one of these tips to get involved. Best thing you can do, stay at home and keep your pets with you. We have been seeing an uptick of actually animals getting lost because people are doing stay-at-home projects and leaving the garage door open and leaving the front door open. their animals aren't wearing ID tags, and it's very difficult because then we can't get them back home to you. So stay inside, stay at home, know where your animal is at all times, do not leave doors open, and make sure that your animal is always wearing an ID tag. And that also includes when you're walking them, you should walk them on a leash. It's very, very important. It's not okay to not walk them on the leash, and that's against the law anyway, so that's a completely different presentation. Animal shelters right now are looking for people who are willing to adopt animals or foster an animal in your home, and you could check out all the different websites to see the processes and what animals might be available for your family to help with. Help return animals in the field. Again, the animal shelters don't really want those animals coming into the shelter because one of the things that we're trying to do is make sure that we have space for animals of victims of COVID. So if we have to temporarily board them, we have space in the animal shelters for that. So what thing you could do is network that animal that you might found on your own. You can go on Nextdoor, you can go on Facebook, knock on your neighbor's doors, put a flyer under their door. Whatever it is that you can do to help find that animal's way back home before you actually have to call the shelter or turn it into the shelter, that would be very much appreciated. Reach out to your neighbors. You might have a neighbor who doesn't have somebody that can help him in the case of an emergency. So know all of your neighbors, know all of your neighbors' pets. Send them a little note or an email or a Facebook message that basically says, I'm there for you. Put me down as your responsible party if something happens to you and I will take care of your pet. Do whatever you can to make sure that your little nucleus and your little community is helping everybody out on a regular basis. Encourage others to do the same. So if you have a network of friends, encourage them all to go to their neighbors. Encourage them all to do the things that I was just talking about. Encourage people to make a plan. Be an advocate for animals and the safety of animals and pets there in the community. And of course, organizations like mine are always looking for donations and support through wish lists of items that we can then pass along to pet owners, or even monetary donations where people can help. So to summarize, there's a couple of points I want to remind you of. First, include your pets in your emergency planning. It's really important that you know where they're going to go and where you're going to go with your pet and who can take your pet if you can't take them. Second of all, know everything that you can know about pets and COVID. There are two really amazing sites. One is the Center for Disease Control and the other one is the American Veterinary Association. I encourage you to check them both out. Make sure you're stocked with supplies and enough supplies for 2 weeks, and that includes your pet food and your pet's amazing treats that they love to have. Protect your pets if they're sick, and that means knowing your veterinarian and making sure you make contact with your veterinarian so you know what their regular hours and procedures are during this time. Enjoy your coworkers, meaning take the time to love your pet and get to know your pet. If you're working from home, maybe your cat's gonna come and sit on your keyboard and it's the time for you to hear some purrs and pet them and really spend quality bonding time with them. And then reunite animals if you find them in the field. Help your neighbors get their animals home without those animals ever coming back into the animal shelter in the first place.